All right. Now let the kids be dismissed for children's church. Grateful for your presence here this day, and happy to be able to get back to our study in the book of Colossians. So if you want to take your Bibles and go to Colossians chapter 1, we are going to hopefully conclude this particular chapter. Okay, so we've spent a lot of time in it because there was so many deep things to be looked at and examined. I heard a story about three mothers who had gotten to a certain age in life where their kids were launched and now they were in their own careers. And they were all bragging on all the things that their kids had done. You know, parents are prone to take great delight in their children. And these mothers were really bragging on their kids. The first mother said, "I'm so proud of my son. He's graduated first in his class from Stanford, and he's now a doctor. He's a doctor, and he makes $250,000 a year in Chicago." Well, the next mother chimes in, and she says, you know, my son, he graduated first in his class in Harvard. And he's a lawyer now, and he's in the Los Angeles area, and he's making $500,000 a year. So this is getting good. Third woman chimes in. She said, "My son never did too well in school. He never went to any university, but now he makes $1,000,000 a year in New York working as a sports repairman." The other women looked at her and said, "What's a sports repairman?" She said, "You know, he fixes games, you know, like hockey and football and fixes games." I thought this was good since they're doing the draft this past week. You know, there's little sports things in the air. He's a sports repairman. Well, listen, I just want you to know that what we're going to look at today really does have something to do with what we looked at. These mothers were all about their children. And do you know what? God is all about you. He really is. And He has a real opportunity in you and me to speak, if you will, to the world around us. What I want to do is I want you to kind of pick up with me a couple of things. And I'm wanting to give you a little bit of a fallback and then a running start into the passage before us. So if you have your Bible open to Colossians 1, I want you to look at verse, let's start back in verse 15. It says, "Who," meaning Christ, "is the image." Christ is the image of the invisible God. He is the image of the invisible God. This means He is the physical, visible manifestation of the invisible God. If we were to go back there and visit it. But this is what we've established as we've looked at it at length. But this is not the only thing He is. It says He is the image of the invisible God. And verse 18 says, "And He is the head of the body, the church." Now, when you think about the body of Christ, we've heard it. Pretty much most of our experience in the faith, we've heard that the church is the body of Christ. Well, here it is set before us in no uncertain terms. But I do think sometimes that we miss the relevance of that. And the relevance of us being the body of Christ is what is before us today. And what I want you to see is after He says He's the head of the body, the church, He says in verse 19, "For it pleased the Father." And this is important. Now, we're going to start digging in. If you have a pencil or a pen, you might want to begin to mark some of the pronouns that are going to follow. Because pronouns get really confusing right now. Because He keeps using the word "He" and "Him." "He" and "Him." And sometimes it's referring to the Father, and sometimes it's referring to the Son. But it's significant to figure out who's who in this in order to make sense of the passage before us. It says, "It pleased the Father that in Christ," and that "Him" is, of course, Christ, "it pleased the Father that in Him should all the fullness dwell." And in verse 20 it says, and I'm going to jump past the explanations, it says, "and to reconcile all things unto Himself." So you can see that the the actor, if you will, in verse 20 is his, it says, it pleased the Lord that in him should all the fullness dwell and to reconcile all things to himself. The himself is the Father. Now, I don't want to dig down into this too much, but if you want to put a little mark by the word, we're just going to have you put a mark by the pronoun that refers to the Father. And the first one is in verse 20, himself. That's the Father. You might want to put a little dot by it or a little mark by it, and you can see how this works later. It says in verse 21, yet now he hath reconciled, or now hath he reconciled us to himself. And this is, he here is also the Father. And I'm going to give them to you ahead of time so we can go back and look at them as I flow through it. Verse 22, it talks about we are unreprovable in his sight, and that's the Father. Now, all of the other ones are going to relate to the Lord Jesus. Now, I know this is hard because it's hard for me to communicate it, but let me see if I can unwrap this for us. Verse 19 says, it pleased the Father that in Christ should all the fullness all fullness dwell. And that means all of the fullness of the Godhead. That means that everything that God is was localized in the person of Jesus Christ. And the Father was happy to have it so. And he wanted him to have it localized in him so that he might reconcile everything in the universe to himself, whether it be people, principalities, whether it be the creative world in which upon which we live and move and have our being. Understand that the whole world lies in the lap of the wicked one. And because of what Christ did, God has not only redeemed his saved believers, but he also has redeemed the world to himself. Romans chapter 8 says right now that the whole world is under a curse and it groans, waiting for the time when everything that is true about us becomes true externally as well as internally, and the curse is done away. And the Bible says that the whole earth groans, waiting for the manifestation of the children of God. So when we become full into our own, the whole creation is going to get released as well from the oppression of the curse. You remember thorns and thistles, right? And we have deserts and we have a lot of bad places on the earth that are very dangerous. God's going to fix it all. And so he says, God is pleased with something here. And my title for the message for us today is The Father's Good Pleasure. The Father's Good Pleasure. I want you to see how he is pleased in all that he has done through Christ. When it talks about him being pleased, we see it said in verse 19, it pleased the Father that in Christ should all the fullness dwell. That's the first thing. We've talked about that at length in previous messages, I believe. We've made the point, reconciliation was part of all that. But he's reconciling all things. And that's the second point. Verse 20 says, and to reconcile all things unto himself. These are the things that please the Father, that in Christ should all the fullness dwell, and it pleases the Father to reconcile all things unto himself by him. In verse 20. See, God, by him, unto himself by him. So you see, Christ comes back into the fore. Now, what does it mean to be reconciled to God? That is an interesting thing to ponder. Reconciliation. So, the pleasure, the good pleasure of the Father is seen in this reconciliation. What is that? We understand the word, at least on its surface, but if we ponder it, it will take us to places perhaps we've not really allowed our minds to go before, partly because of the confusion that is had over some of these wordings and some of these pronouns. So what I want you to think in terms of is if somebody has a falling out and they're reconciled, that means they're pretty much back into a relationship, right? Now, what kind of relationship would God have us to have with himself? Is it a distant relationship, as it seems to be in many people's lives as Christians, that they don't have a relationship that's vital, that's intimate, that's real, that's tangible, that's, you know, in their mind, something they can point to and say, I just know God is with me every single day. You see, we may know it in our minds, but do we know it in our experience? Because God would have us to know it in our experience, that he's there, that he's reconciled to us. You recall in the book of Genesis that the Bible says that God walked with Adam in the cool of the day. That's pretty close. You often might put that in your mind as just this really hand-in-hand kind of thing. You know, when a couple is having difficulty communicating, or there's a little bit of a hurt feelings that have happened in that relationship, when everything is worked out and there is a reconciliation in regard to whatever the issue might have been, the holding of the hands comes natural. God reconciled us to Himself. He wants us to have that relationship renewed in our experience that was lost back in the Garden of Eden. And the good pleasure of the Father is seen in His reconciling act. The Bible says it pleased the Father to reconcile us to Himself in verse 20. And it says, and you hath He reconciled in verse 21. And again, this is the Father. He reconciled us. Now you will go through this and you could lose your way by thinking, well, is that Christ that did this, or is it God that did this? Is it the Father or the Son? Who's doing what? But I'm trying to streamline you through it. It pleased the Father to reconcile all things unto Himself by Christ in verse 20, and you hath He reconciled in verse 21. That's what He did. God framed this plan of salvation in the deep recesses of eternity. We don't even understand the depths of God's riches and wisdom and knowledge. He just did it, okay? The Bible says that Christ was foreordained before the foundations of the world, that He would die. Okay, we just went off the rails and my mind can't get there. But I do know this, that the Father had pleasure in allowing His Son to become the reconciling agent in redemption. For you and for me, we've now been reconciled. This is not just theory. It is not just theology. It is reality. We have been reconciled to God. Now, you may not feel that. And if you don't feel it, sometimes it's because of a misunderstanding of what's really transpired here. The Bible says that it pleased the Father to reconcile us. And in verse 21, and you He has reconciled. And when He says that, He's talking to the Colossians. This is a group of people who have begun to wander from the truth they had received. Chapter 1 talks about how wonderful their beginnings were, and the rest of the book is about how they're getting off into the left field. They were looking for some legal things to look at and say, ah, you did this, and we did this, we did this, we did this. They're keeping laws, they're observing feast days, and they're taking a little bit of the Jewish paradigm and putting that in their experience. They're looking at angels, and they're worshiping angels, chapter 2 will bring before us. And that was sort of their own past paradigm. They were looking for the comfortable rather than the fruits of conversion. Okay? Because when you get converted, something happens. Everything changes. When you're reconciled, you're no longer at enmity with God. The Bible says in verse 21, and you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind, by wicked works hath He reconciled. And that's what we were. But we're not that anymore. And the works thing begins to fall away because we don't worry about the works as much as we worry about worship. Okay, we want to get close back to Him. Do you know, if you would go back and touch that day when you came to Christ and there was some newness regenerated in your life because God is the regenerator, we were born again, something happened. The scales fell off of your eyes. You began to see the world differently. There was a buoyancy. There was a sense of your forgiveness because God's Spirit made it so. You know, when you get saved, the Bible talks about the Spirit Himself bearing witness with our spirit that we're the children of God, and that if any man has not the Spirit, we are none of His, they are none of His. Understand that when you look at this, and I'm talking about experience, and you're maybe thinking, well, I don't remember anything like that. There's only a couple reasons I can see why that might be. One is maybe you didn't understand properly at the beginning, or maybe you're very young, because the Holy Spirit comes in, and He comes in and takes up residence. He becomes the earnest, the down payment, the guarantee of our salvation. And the Bible talks about He ain't leaving. He seals us. Now, when we get the Holy Spirit by virtue of our salvation, when we come to Christ as our Savior, He changes everything. We're reconciled. We're no more enemies. We're no more doing wicked works. Or we're not supposed to be. At first we get it, but then if we get along the way and the world draws us back in quickly, as it does sometimes, we begin to think, well, that's a distant memory. And I want to appeal to us today to remember the day when you touched the cross, or when I should say the cross touched you. Remember the day when you got lit up. Remember the day when there was something real being set forth before your heart and your mind. Because that was the day God reconciled you. And you remain reconciled even if your back is toward God. The Bible says that you, even though you were enemies and alienated in your mind by wicked works, yet now has He reconciled. And I want to suggest to you that it pleased the Lord to reconcile us. That's what it did. This is not something God did haphazardly. It's not something He did reluctantly. This was the pleasure of the Lord, as we see from verse 19. Now, if you've ever been a yard saler, a garage saler, or maybe just like going to shops and you picked up something off of the shelf and you noticed that it was cracked or broken or a piece was missing, probably you would put it back and get one that was in good shape. What I'm saying to you is God went through the marketplace of sin, which was this world, and He picked us up and He looked at us and saw we were all cracked and He couldn't find a good one in the bunch. The Bible says God concluded all under sin, and then He gave Christ, then nevertheless, to still go and die for us. The Bible says God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. So the Father loves you. The Father loves you. He gave His only begotten Son that whoever would believe in Him would not perish, but have everlasting life. There's either permanence in your soul or there's perishing destined for the soul. These are the only two options. And God loves us. And it's His pleasure to reconcile you. So when you look in the mirror and you feel like, wow, man, I'm really not amounting to much, I just want to remind you the Father was pleased and He knew you the end from the beginning. And because He knew the end from the beginning, you've never shocked Him and you've never disappointed Him. You are on the right track. The Bible says there is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. To those who walk not after the flesh, but according to the Spirit. What it is saying to us is that there's no condemnation from God, but there might be a little condemnation, self-condemnation, you know, the devil's condemnation, but not from God, because that same chapter that starts, "There is no condemnation," says, "What shall be able to separate us from the love of God?" Nothing present, nothing to come, no heights, no depths, no principalities, no powers. Listen, nothing can separate you from the love of God. And when I say that, I'm trying to show you that though you may feel self-condemned sometimes because you turned left or right, you've stumbled and you've bruised yourself and you've even created some havoc and reaped some consequences, you may feel like you need to do something otherwise than what God would have you do. And what He would have you to do is to walk with Him. To have a relationship with Him. To go back and renew the first things, as the church at Ephesus was told. You've left your first love, He said. You need to remember those old things. And you need to return and you need to repent. And you need to redo the things you used to do. Don't give up. Don't quit. Don't stay down when you fall down. Because the Father is pleased with this reconciliation arrangement. He is there for you. And the Bible says, "He that comes to me, I will in no wise cast out." No condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. The Bible tells us that God, if God be for us, who can be against us? See, these are things we need to understand. Because this reconciliation that God was pleased to do is a reconciliation that is very central to how you're going to behave and react. It is a word, this whole thing that He brings before us in verse 22 brings it into a clearer focus. He says, "He hath reconciled us," in verse 21, and it says, "in the body of His Son's flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in His, the Father's, sight." Now, this is where it gets tricky, but if you keep those certain ones, certain pronouns underlined and read it later, it'll make sense for you. But at this point, I want you to understand that word "present." Because when I first read this, I think of the Son taking His bride and presenting her to His Father. And that was my first reading of it. As I began to read it, I began to realize that this is part of the Father's pleasure. He hath reconciled us, And He has reconciled us in order to present us unreprovable, unblameable, and holy in His sight. In other words, He presents us to Himself. Now, the thing to keep in mind is that this is speaking of the church as the body of Christ, not the bride of Christ. So if He's presenting the body of Christ to Himself, suddenly we're dynamically connected to Jesus. What did Jesus do? He came into the world and He lived a perfect, righteous life, a serving life, a life that condescended, a life that loved. And now that the head, Christ, who's the firstborn from the dead, has risen from the dead and ascended on high, you and I are still here as His representatives. We are the body of Christ. Why does the world hate the church, the true church of God? Because they hate Jesus. Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? Who are you, Lord? I am Jesus whom you persecute. Who was He persecuting? He was persecuting the church, but He's the head, it's His body. We are the representatives. And what I want you to see in this situation He's setting before us here is that these people in Colossae were going after the worship of angels. They were going after the paradigm of the Jewish people with the feast days and all of these works-oriented kind of a religious system. And they were falling into the rut that they were familiar with as well as one that they were willing to work with because it was easier. You see, the reality is for you and me that when we are reconciled to God, we are made to be present or to be He presents us to Himself. And this word is a fascinating word. It actually has the idea of being stood beside God. It's a word to stand beside Him. And so you and I stand beside God in the world. We don't stand a distance away from God. We go into the world and God's right there beside us. We are reconciled to God. So everywhere we go, we're taking our Lord with us. Just like Jesus did. Begin to see it? Clouds beginning to... You go, He goes. Okay? And when we go with Him in fellowship, that is you being what you need to be. The problem that these individuals probably were facing as Colossians were that they were finding out that was not an easy thing. It was not an easy thing. I want to share a couple of passages with you that are here and there throughout the New Testament that talks about our reconciliation being a standing beside the Father. John chapter 8 and verse 30 through 32, it says, as He spake these words, Jesus speaking, it says, as He spake these words, many believed on Him. Then said Jesus to those Jews that did believe on Him, if you continue in My word, then are you My disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Many Christians are not free because they're not continuing. The Bible says you are reconciled, verse 21, back in Colossians 1. And it says in verse 23, if you continue in the faith. See, you can be saved and reconciled, but you're not continuing. And Jesus said these disciples who believed in John chapter 8, they believed on Him. And He says, if you continue in My word, then are you My disciples indeed. Acts chapter 11 and verse 23 says this, who, when he came and had seen the grace of God, this is talking about Barnabas. Barnabas came down to see what was going on in the city. And it says, when he had seen the grace of God, he was glad and he exhorted them. Listen to this. He exhorted them all that with purpose of heart they would cleave unto the Lord. The number one thing the devil wants to do in your life right now is to break your fellowship with God. He can't break our relationship, but he can break our fellowship. And we cleave, therefore, unto the Lord. Okay? So there's this tension that is created upon being reconciled and trying to grow in our faith. Acts chapter 14 and verse 22. Now listen, I'm going to read this verse, but put this in your mind. This is right after Paul was stoned with stones, left for dead, and then he got up out of the rubble and walked back into the city. The next day he comes out and he says these words to the people that watched him be stoned to death. As far as they knew, he was dead. Many believe he caught up to the third heaven at this point. But this is what Paul said after showing them. I just got stoned to death. And the Bible says in verse 22 of chapter 14, Acts, It says he was there confirming the souls of the disciples, listen to this, and exhorting them to continue in the faith, and that we must through much tribulation enter into the kingdom of heaven, or kingdom of God. Now think about that. What a punctuated message. We're going to get into the kingdom of God through much tribulation. You need to continue in the faith. You know what happened to me yesterday? I got stoned with stones. They threw me out as the offscouring of the earth. And so he's telling them, continue, even though it may get hard. 1 John chapter 2, verse 27 says this, "But the anointing which you have received of him abideth in you. And you need not that any man teach you, but as the same anointing teacheth you of all things, and is truth, and is no lie, and even as it hath taught you, you shall abide in him." You will continue. Now, yes, round the bend and back around the corner. We've all been there in driving. We're going somewhere. And, you know, we take a wrong turn. We have to do a loop. You're going to take wrong turns. But because you know the truth, and the more truth you know, the quicker you can recover. But because you know the truth, you will abide in him because he's abiding in you. And he says, because you have this anointing, because the Holy Spirit's there, because he ain't leaving, he says, you will abide in him. Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 32 and 33 says this, "Call to remembrance the former days, in which after you were illuminated, you endured a great fight of afflictions." He's talking about these believers in Hebrews, and their whole problem was is they were getting ready to bail on the Lord Jesus because he wasn't from the tribe of Levi. And they were like, well, he can't be a priest. He was from Judah. And of course, he makes the argument. He was from the priesthood of Melchizedek, which predated Levi. And the point is he says, don't lose the plot. Remember how when you first got lit up, you were willing to endure the affliction, the ostracizing. The Bible says in Luke, blessed are you when men exclude you. You had some hits you took. People, well, why do you need that? Or you'll get over it. Or they'll try to talk you out of it many times. And sometimes if they can't have any prevalence in that, they will give you difficulty in other ways and begin to persecute. But he says, remember after you were illuminated, how you endured a great fight of affliction? Chapter 10, verse 33 of Hebrews says, "Partly while you were made a gazing stock, both by reproaches and afflictions, and partly while you became companions of them that were so used." He says, you remember when you got saved, you started hanging out with people that weren't like the people you used to hang out with, and you were glad to do it? You were glad to affiliate with the lowly? You were glad to serve and to worship and to sing, and those things meant something, remember? And he's trying to talk them off of the ledge of bailing on Christ. He says, you have need of endurance in Hebrews 10. So he talks about them being a gazing stock. Do you know when you got to be part of the body of Christ, you became a gazing stock? When you were his body, now God purposefully intends that in our reconciliation, we be made gazing stocks. He says in Hebrews 10:33, he says, partly while you were made a gazing stock. Now you know what they do at the stocks, right? Remember the stocks? They have this person in society who needs a little humiliation. He's done something the society has been offended by. They take these two pieces of wood, cut out a place for the hands and for the head, put their heads in there, and they'd set them in the middle of the street. And they would hold them there for perhaps the whole day. No rest. Can't sit down. Just miserable. And people would throw rotten fruit and rotten vegetables at them. He says, you were made a gazing stock. Do you know what they did to Jesus? He was made a gazing stock. And they took him and they nailed him to a cross. He says, you're the body of Christ. You've been reconciled. And he's saying to all of these people, whether it's in the book of Acts, the book of Hebrews, and we're going to see in the book of Peter, we're going to see that part of our calling is to be made gazing stocks for the world. 1 Peter chapter 4 says, they think it's strange that you don't run with them to the same excess of riot, speaking evil of you, who shall give an account to him that is ready to judge the quick and the dead. Who is going to give an account? The lost man who made fun of you, who threw the rotten fruit, who persecuted you. You see, as persons who are affiliated with Christ as his body in the real world, you make some people bristle. The Bible says that we are a savor of life unto life and a savor of death unto death. So if people are lost, they're going to hate on the Christian. If people are saved, they're going to say, "Ah, brother, what an oasis this person represents in my life," just to be around them. He says that these people are going to give an account to him that is ready to judge the quick and the dead. For this cause was the gospel preached unto them also that are dead, that they might be judged according to men in the flesh, but live according to God in the Spirit. See, when God preaches, he preaches to dead people. And those that hear will come forth from their deadness and be born again and be saved. Jesus talked about that he was talking to a crowd. He says, many of the dead are hearing me now. And he says they're going to be judged. God's going to judge the quick and the dead. And the reason that God allows them to think it's strange that you don't live like they do anymore is because he's going to judge them, and he's put you in their world to prick their conscience and to make them to realize they're going to give an account with what they did with you, what they did with Christ, what they did with the Word of God, and the truth that might be known. 1 Peter chapter 4, 13, that was 4 through 6, but it goes on, it says, but rejoice, because of this whole, being spoken evil of verse 4 in 1 Peter, it says in 4:13, it says, rejoice inasmuch as you are partakers of Christ's sufferings. See, redemption is still going on. It's still, Jesus paid it all, but he's left us here, boots on the ground, to continue to represent the truth that God so loved the world. That's our calling. The Colossians had lost the plot. They were looking at angels. They were looking at certain rituals, and they were thinking, this is what we get. He says, no. He's the head of the body. You are his body. You are now here. And God is pleased to reconcile you and to present you, listen, to present you to the world. That's what he's doing. How does he present you to the world? He presents you to the world as people who are holy, sacred in God's sight. That's what it means. You are sacred in God's sight. No matter what you do, washed in the blood. Amen? That's good. You cannot be distanced from him in any way. You are absolutely accepted by God. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. You are made holy and you are unblameable. You know, every time you turn around, you do something stupid, you think, oh man, I shouldn't have done that. The devil runs into the throne room of God and says, see? And Jesus stands up and says, I got that one too. I got that one. You cannot blame the child of God at the bar of God because the Son of God stands and advocates for us. You need to see how secure you are in him so that you can kind of, okay, I'm just going to do Jesus. I'm going to love on him and I don't care what the fallout is because I've been made holy. I'm a sacred entity in the real world. He reconciled me. He put me to stand right beside him. He presents me to the world as somebody who is number one, holy, number two, unblameable, number three, unreprovable in his sight. You know, it's crazy these days. You know, you see these different situations where young people are so far off the rails, and you think, man, even a mother would have a hard time, putting up with this or this behavior or whatever. But it's not so. Mothers many times can look beyond all that. Even if their child did something so awful, they would be at their execution if they needed to be. A mother would be there. She would be happy about what he did. It might break her heart. And the Bible says we can break God's heart. The Bible says that we are not to grieve the Holy Spirit. We're not to quench the Holy Spirit. Do you see how condescending God becomes to you and me? That he would allow us to do that? To grieve him and to quench him? He ain't leaving. So if we continue to go headlong to the left or to the right, we're going to be miserable and we're going to be grieving him, but he's loving on us. We are unreprovable. Jesus paid it all. And he says it's part of the pleasure of the Lord that he has reconciled us to present us holy, unblameable, and unreprovable in his sight to the world. The world sees the church and the true church I'm talking about, not the church as Christendom is represented today, but the true child of God and children of God who make up the true church, they are unreprovable and unblameable in God's sight. He loves them, and he presents us to the world, just like he presented Jesus. When Jesus went down into the waters to be baptized, John said, behold, the Lamb of God, and he presented his Son to the world. And for you and me, we are now being sent forth into the world and being presented As we saw in Acts, he says you're going to, through much tribulation, enter, and you need to get your mind around the fact that it has been granted unto you not only to believe, as Philippians tells us in chapter 1, but also to suffer for Christ's sake. You and I go through a world that has gone mad, and we're trying to maintain our sanity. Could you imagine being placed into a mental hospital where the people, I mean, extremely mentally incapacitated people, people who are raving, and you know, they talk about raving, you know, in those places. And yet you're fine, everybody knows you're fine, and so they don't do anything for you, but you're still a part of the inmates, okay? You're part of the patient ward, you're on the list. That's what we live in. We live in a world that's stark raving mad. And we are trying to maintain our clarity. And the only way we can do that is by being close to the Lord. And He made that possible by reconciling us through the blood of His cross. And so when He says that we are this, we are unblameable, unreprovable, holy in His sight, He says, if you continue, the if is not about your salvation. The if is about whether you are going to be useful to Him in this capacity. You and I, who are born again, have been brought into the family of God to be made gazing stocks. This is what I'm trying to establish for us. And it's going to be hard sometimes. And we're going to want to flip over to the ritual. We're going to want to flip maybe over to the angelic and get into some super mystical stuff like they did. But He says, no. He says, no. He says, you've been saved to be a gazing stock. Own it. You are the body of Christ. As if He was right there where you are His body. And the Bible says that in verse 23, if you continue in the faith, grounded and settled, and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel. Underline or circle the word hope, because that's what he referenced back in verse 5. He says, you had faith in Christ and you had love for saints because of the hope, for the hope. What's the hope? What the hope is we're going to have eternal life. That in His presence is fullness of joy. At His right hand are pleasures forevermore. The hope is we're going to get out of this mess. And everything's going to be okay. And that no matter what goes on down here, our Father is writing the story. And He will sustain us in the most dire of straits. That is the hope. That He's not only going to come and get us, but He's going to get us through this. You and I are up against insurmountable odds, humanly speaking. The entire world would have us to believe we came from monkeys. It would have us to believe that there is no morality, there is no right and wrong, that there is no standard, there is no God, that the universe just came into being out of nothing. It would continue to tell you all of these things to the point where you would begin to walk lockstep with them. If you tell a child he's an animal, came from an animal, he will behave like an animal. It's an inevitability. You may remember years ago, probably the 70s, that whole song, Muskrat Love. That's what they get. They get muskrat love, jumping from place to place to place. Immorality gets a pass in the paradigm of the world. But we understand there's a God in heaven who gave us commandments, and He gave us prophecies, and He gave us truth, and He gave us insight, and He gave us not only all of the truth about eternity, but He proved that there is an eternity to be really reached for and aspired to on the right side when His Son died, having said He would, and on the third day He rose again. He proved that He went to prepare a place for us and that He will come again and receive us unto Himself. He proved it by His own example. And you and I, the Bible says of Christ in Peter, it says He's left us an example that we should follow in His steps. And that means suffering. And suffering is no fun. So if I put that on the front burner when I'm sharing Christ with somebody, hey, you want to get saved and get some suffering? They're going to, I don't know, what's where's that suffering thing? What's that all about? No, we just tell them about Jesus. Let the Holy Spirit bring to their heart what's true. But as you get saved, you begin to realize there's a loop, a joy, a buoyancy, a blessing, a peace, a contentment, a clarity. It's all there. What would it be worth to know all about Jesus in personal experience as well as on the pages of Scripture, and then have the opportunity to represent Him to your sister or your brother and win them to Jesus? Is it worth that? You know, you see somebody sitting outside of their home, and the home is on fire. It's engulfed in flames. The door, there's a little clarity. They open theirs, but the windows, you know. And somebody comes up to the parent, and they say, do you know, we don't know where your daughter is. We don't have her. You have a daughter? We didn't even see anybody but you and her and him. But we, and dad or mom bolts through that door and says, I don't care. I'm going in. Now that's the kind of suffering we're called to. People's souls are at stake. And we're willing to bear the reproach. The Bible says it of the old rugged cross, I will ever be true. It's shame and reproach I'm going to gladly bear. Okay, that's where we got to live. Because that's what we're called to. And when he says that we are reconciled, and we are now presented to the world as unreprovable, unblameable, and holy, he says, you did all this. He says, you got to remember where you came from. He says, if you continue and be not moved away from the hope. The hope is that thing that draws you forward. The only reason you'd run through that door is to think maybe you'd get your daughter out of there. My point is hard to make, but I think we understand what I'm saying here. The Bible says in this passage that you and I need to remember the hope that was in the gospel when we heard it. He says, this is a hope that you heard in this gospel that you heard and which was preached to every creature which is under heaven, whereof I, Paul, verse 23, am made a minister who now rejoice in my sufferings. Circle the word now. Where is Paul? Paul is in prison. He might have had a bad day till he started writing this letter. He says, you know what? This ain't for nothing. I'm in prison. Why am I in prison? I'm in prison for you. For your faith, for your strengthening, for your encouragement, for your uplifting, for your buoyancy. To see that as I have suffered, so you will suffer. As Christ suffered, so you will suffer. He says, I rejoice in my sufferings for you and fill up that which is behind, listen to this, which is behind of the afflictions of Christ. Did Christ not do enough? No, he did everything he needed to do. He died for our sins. He was buried and he rose again. All according to the scriptures. He did what he did. But he's the head and we're the body. And the body's still here moving around doing the good stuff. And if you have to suffer for Jesus' sake, then so be it. Because that's what God would have put on our plate that day. And so when people watch the Christian go through suffering and difficulty, they see something different about them. They may be weeping, but they're singing in the prison. Remember Paul and Silas in Philippians 16. They'd been beaten. They couldn't sleep. They're just up singing hymns. And then God says, okay, you guys are showing them something. I'm going to take it up a notch, and I'm going to break open all the doors in this prison. And he did. God broke open all the doors. What was happening was the world was seeing what God was presenting. What did God present? God presented Paul and Silas. What does God present to your generation and mine? He presents us. And he says, I now rejoice in my sufferings because I see it's purposeful. And every time you go through something, if you see the hope that is set before you, you know there's a purpose in it. And he says, we rejoice now in our sufferings. I rejoice now in my sufferings for you and fill up that which is behind of the afflictions of Christ in my body, in my flesh, for his body's sake, which is the church. You see, we all are interconnected. And he says, when I suffer, the whole body suffers, but there's purpose in the suffering. Everybody comes here and looks and sees what's going on and see how God shows up. When you go through the valley of the shadow of death, you won't have to fear any evil because more than ever, you're going to know you are with me. Okay. Sometimes we lose the plot because we got it so easy. But when afflictions come, we begin to see he's so good. We forget that. And Paul says, listen, I now rejoice. Even because this is, you know, you guys are chasing the mystical, you're chasing the liturgical. He says, no. He says, look at what I'm doing. I'm not chasing either one of them. I'm in prison and I'm happy. I'm a happy guy. I'm glad to be here in prison for the body's sake. Not for nothing. It's for the body's sake. And it's for the people who were in the prison yard, you know, the prison guards. You know, Paul was talking to the Philippians. He says, don't worry about me, man. I want to just let you know, many of the prison guards have gotten saved. So it wasn't for nothing. Wherever you are, he is because you stand with him and he presents you to the world with whatever you go through. He says that I am a minister according to, he says he does this for the body's sake, verse 25. He says, whereof I am made a minister according to the dispensation of God, which is given to me for you to fulfill the word of God. What is the word of God's fulfillment? What is the fulfillment of the word of God? God wants to reconcile all men to himself. The Bible says that God commands all men everywhere to repent now. says at times of this ignorance, God winked at, now commands all men everywhere to repent. God is not willing that any should perish. So what is God's will? What is God's word all about? It's about Jesus. It's about reconciliation. History is indeed His story. And we understand that He's the head, we're the body, we're boots on the ground. We are presented to the world in a position of standing that is something to behold for the world. What does Jesus say in the Sermon on the Mount? Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. So if we're not in affliction, maybe we need more to be occupied with the stuff we can do while it's still peaceful, right? That's how we let our light shine. We may not be being chased by the powers that be. We thought it might come to that, and it may come to that again. You know, things come around, they get closer every time. But right now, we're in the good ground. And God would have us to know it's not about liturgy. It's not about mysticism. It's about being part of the body of Christ, that He's the head. And where He goes, where He sends you will go, and what He says you will do, and you just try to live for Him in the day-to-day, reflecting His character and His heart. When you fall down, you admit it. That's what a Christian does. Paul said, I'm a wretch, man. He says, I'm the chief of sinners, man. You want to hear about my Jesus, though? I got something to tell you there, because I got nothing. I got nothing, but He's got it all. Oh, beloved, for you and I, we have been reconciled. And it was the pleasure of the Father to make us to be so. But we do have the control of verse 23. If you continue, you might not continue. You may be that other oxen in the yoke that's chafing at the neck because you're constantly working against it. But that's usually because of a misunderstanding. If you understand that we are called to walk this pathway for His sake as His body, it begins to sanctify whatever it is that we have to lay down, whatever it is we have to pick up, however it is we have to suffer, or however it is we have to serve. We are willing. We become willing to do that. Paul says this thing was a mystery in verse 26. It was hidden from generations and ages. This mystery. What mystery? You know, in the 483rd year of Daniel's 70 weeks of years prophecy, the clock stopped and Jesus is coming back for a 7-year tribulation. The mystery was that parenthesis, which you and I live in, where God would take the Gentiles as well as Jews during the parentheses, and He would interject you and me as His body, boots on the ground, martyrs throughout the history of the church, being burned at the stake, thrown to the lions, crucified upside down, being taken and beaten with clubs, being maligned, tortured, and so forth in inquisitions. All of the things that the church has endured, they've endured while singing the songs of Zion. And this is what you and I are called to.